one of the largest bike parking facilities in the world. We are currently in the bike parking garage underneath the central station of the city of Den Haag, The Hague, which has room for almost 8,000 bikes. Due to the COVID pandemic, the bike parking garage is not used up to its maximum capacity at this moment, but you will see that it's used, and later on we'll offer you a virtual tour through this bike parking garage. And between the show, you might hear some sounds from people biking parking their bike or taking their bike. So that's all sort of a part of this live entertainment show. My name is Lucas Harms. I'm the managing director of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. And I will be your host today during this show. And we have a packed and very exciting agenda, full of fantastic elements. And we'll showcase you some of the important ingredients to boost your Dutch cycling knowledge. We have several 5-minute pitches from organizations from our public-private network of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. We will learn about Dutch cycling intelligence, Dutch knowledge clips, and we also will boost and introduce a guide focusing on the best practices of Dutch cycling. Of course, it's also possible to send in all your questions in the chat. And if there's time, we will answer your questions. But let's start the show. And I will start self with a short introduction of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. Who are we and what are we doing? The Dutch Cycling Embassy is a public-private network focused on sustainable bicycle inclusive mobility. We have almost 80 partner organizations, civil organizations, knowledge institute, private partners, and public agencies, all with the common goal of transferring the best practices from the Netherlands, the knowledge, the experience, the products, and the expertise that we've been developed for the last 40 or 50 years, to transfer that to other countries and cities around the world. Here you see an overview of all our different partners and the countries which we have been active in. So that's basically what we are. How are we doing that? We are doing that in several ways, which are can be summarized under the umbrella of four pillars: experience, think, act, and learn. With experience, I mean like the delegations that are visiting the Netherlands. We show them around, let them experience the Dutch streetscapes. We also go to foreign countries to boost the conditions in other cities with tailor-made think bike workshops. In addition, we look at applying solutions to local context, and it's always very important to mention that it's not copy-pasting Dutch solutions, it's really making them tailor-made according to the local, social, geographical, and cultural conditions. And last but not least, we have the learn element, in which we offer all kinds of learning modules, and that's also the central focus of today's and this afternoon's session. We will bring you several elements of our learn program. And basically, that's about offering all kinds of trainings, webinars, e-courses, and educational models to boost, and with the common aim, actually, to boost the Dutch cycling knowledge to individual capacities, educational skills, knowledge, and expertise with the overarching element to increase the and to boost the cycling conditions around the world. And with that short introduction, I want to give over to the first speaker of today, and that's Joost de Kruijf. Joost de Kruijf, a very warm welcome. Great to have you here. Joost is a research and business innovator at the Breda University of Applied Sciences, and also one of the founding fathers of DCE Learn. So it's fantastic to have you here, and I would love to give the floor to you.
Oh, thanks, Lucas. Yeah, thanks a lot for having me, I would say. In the next 15 minutes, I will try to explain to you the essence about Dutch cycling intelligence. And for that, we have to start where I think all contribution to the Dutch Cycling Embassy started, and that's Velo City in Nantes. That was the first encounter of the Breda University of Applied Sciences with the Dutch Cycling Embassy. And the main thing we got out of there, that it's really great fun to be connected to the Dutch Cycling Embassy. And we met a lot of people, which we didn't know of, who all had cycling intelligence with them. So we start off at Velo City Nantes. This we often use, so I briefly explain, we are a University of Applied Sciences, so we try to explain why we develop knowledge and how we develop knowledge. And for one, and what you see now is the king of the Netherlands. It's not for you an uncommon person. But what we focus on is experience on the bike, the bike path and the cyclist themselves and the interaction between them. And that's interesting because I'm going to introduce somebody, and that's Joris van Damme. I met Joris in a European project we did, and Joris is rethinking cycling. And he said, yeah, it's nice to collaborate with the Dutch because you know all about cycling. And then I told Joris already, and he agreed instantly, there is hardly anybody who knows everything about cycling. You have all kinds of specialists, and because we are so common with cycling, it's, yeah, I would say, impossible to know everything. So what Joris introduced is we have to rethink cycling, and if we want to take cycling seriously, we have to get to another plan. So while you see a lot of cities like Paris and other cities around the world thinking about the 15-minute city and the cycling city, together with Joris, we developed the policy life cycle, where we divided everything into four phases. We have the planning phase. So in the Netherlands, and maybe it's good for the understanding, in the Netherlands there are a lot of people who are engaged with cycling planning, but also we have a lot of people also within the context of Dutch Cycling Embassy who know a lot about how to build it, design it. Yeah, you first design it and then build it, but afterwards we have to get people on the bike. So there are a lot of cycling incentive programs with a lot of specialists on that. And the latest, because a lot of people will not know me, actually, we are focusing more on data-driven cycling policy enhancement. So we are mostly positioned in the cycling monitoring and evaluation. And I would not say that I'm the specialist in all, but it's really good to have the understanding from the University of Applied Sciences. We collaborate with a lot of parties within the Dutch Cycling Embassy and people from foreign countries, which we meet and add up. So what I wanted to do after this short introduction about that there are more specialists needed to fit the whole puzzle. The interesting part is this one. This is one of our key values. This is where we translate GPS data and policy relevant insights. And the key is that we met great guys from Austria, from Bike Citizens, and I added a picture of Daniel Koffler. Together with them, we rethought the whole mechanism of GPS data and cycling. And that's cool because abroad there are lots of specialists too in a specific field. So that's about the Bike Citizens. Question for you, do you recognize this picture?
It looks like a fantastic and cozy cafe.
Yeah, it is, it is. And at the same time, it's a scene from the film A Beautiful Mind, which we commonly use in explaining why we have to do something different to get the car congestion down, and cycling is one of them. But with one of my colleagues, we did a lot of exploration about tax and road pricing. It's Dirk van Amersfoort from Goud Appel Koffing. And there the idea, and I use this example quite often, there it was, because the bottom line in The Beautiful Mind was that there is a theory about system optimization. So if you want to reduce car congestion, you have to do something. And then the bottom line there is everybody has to do what's best for himself and the group. And I think with that line, with all the specialists in Dutch Cycling Embassy, I thought we have to do something with Dutch cycling intelligence. But because to have the best impact that everybody starts cycling and having as much cycling knowledge as possible, we have to do what's best for himself. So all the parties within the Cycling Embassy and abroad are important, and if we then look at the perspective, we do what's best for ourselves and the group, we get one step or one notch better or higher, and then we should be able to reach higher objectives than only the sum of all the individual contributions. So that's maybe a bit conceptual, but that was why I thought we have to do something with Dutch cycling intelligence. The cool part is, and that's an example which was recently developed, this is a national standard on qualitative research on cycle highway behavior and experience. And with that example, a whole lot of different specialists from road authorities, consultancy agencies and some colleagues from the academic world combined their forces to build a protocol, how to put it in place, how we should do a proper survey. Next, all the data coming out of the survey is enriched automatically in the system, and afterwards it's visualized in a nice Power BI monitoring dashboard. And the key is that we then reduce all barriers for road authorities to use this method to get a national understanding about the quality of cycle behavior and experience on cycle highways. And that's massive, because then we can build up our knowledge and actually start comparing examples from the Randstad, for example, with projects in the southern part of Holland. So that's really cool, and that's, I think, also compliments to the process of the Tour de Force. They will be later in with some other examples, but I thought I'll just highlight it because I think this is one thing which is in the heart of cycling intelligence. This is another thing, and it's nice because we send this over on LinkedIn. And if you ask yourselves, what are we looking at? It's the map of De Heek with the cyclability of all train stations in the area. So we presented this, and the first one to act on this was the city of De Heek itself. And they said, yeah, but we have train stations and we have bus, tram, metro. So next to the cyclability of train station, we also have to look at the cyclability of the other public transport services in the city. So then De Heek shows green. I thought I'll use this one. The interesting part is, because this is one half of the puzzle, and I'm happy to give you the scoop of the day, that we developed this for the whole country. So from next week's upon, every road authority in Holland has the cyclability of all public transport stations. And you'd say, okay, that's cool, we are proud of that. Key is that that's only the start, and what we did actually with another data source, we derived all the distance decay functions, so we now know how much people are willing to take the bike to the public train stations, to shopping centers, to education, because, and I don't have to explain that to you, but the longer the distance, the likelihood of cycling decreases. So it's not really likely that people will cycle 15 kilometers to go grocery shopping. So to get better understanding, we as Breda University of Applied Sciences developed this. And the interesting part is, and then I'm sure that I forget people from the Netherlands who are really good at this, but the guys like Niels van Aert from TU Delft, Raymond Huisman, Goud Appelkoffing and Roland Kager and Paul van der Koevering are well known for their combination between cyclability and, for example, spatial planning or train optimization. So the bike-train combination, which are really powerful. So, and that helps out, I think, by visualizing who is good in what. So you shouldn't call those guys, I think, to design a cycle highway. But if you want to rethink the concept of 50-minute cities, spatial planning and accessibility by bike, those are the guys to call. And that's cool because they're all part of the cycling embassy. And I think a couple of weeks ago, we made a joint effort in the USA to give presentations with some of these. So I think that strengthens, and that are the examples that one creates an opportunity and the other try to finish it. So that's cool. Again, I know I forget people, so don't feel insulted. And if you want to know more, please call Lucas, because he has the perfect overview of the cycling embassy. Last thing which I want to introduce to you, I think it's a bit of a scoop too, because, and that's coming back to my daily life, when I explain to people, because in your introduction you said you are a research and business developer. When I tell people I do research and business development into cycling, people say, but, and my neighbor asked, but everybody can cycle, so what is there to be researched and business innovated on cycling? And then I told him that the bike we are now buying in the shop is not the bike we are used to buying 25 years ago. The bike path is changing, cyclists are different. So what we try to do is to get the concept of Dutch cycling intelligence and everything which comes together there, put that in a fancy short movie, which I would really like to show now. And I hope it turns also the perspective that cycling is great, and if you have positive energy, so the music behind the movie is also quite light and entertaining. But I hope with this, and that's the end of my presentation, in addition to this part of the show, as you like to call it, we'll watch the movie, and then I hope the concept of Dutch cycling intelligence came across.
Easy. It's easy if there's a perfect balance between infrastructure, the bicycle, and those who pedal the wheels. However, isn't obvious. So many variations and combinations create infinite situations. This is what makes understanding cycling rather complex. That's where cycle intelligence kicks in. Quest for insights and answers provides us valuable roadmaps on the future of cycling, bringing cycling to the next level.
Yes, thanks very much, Joost, for this fantastic inspirational presentation. And we now go to the next speaker, which is Taije Gorris. He's team leader capacity building at DTV Capacity Building, and a very experienced consultant with loads of experience and didactic skills. Currently also enrolled in a World Bank course, which he's giving to, for instance, to the Philippines. It's an honor to have you. The floor is yours.
Great. Thank you very much, Lucas. Billions are invested across the world to create new or to upgrade temporary or existing cycling infrastructure. It is the quality of the plans and designs that determine the success. Where routes are planned, how lanes and intersections are designed, determine whether cyclists feel safe enough to start cycling or cycle more. Did you know that with a personal investment of only a couple of hours, you can acquire valuable insights, skills, and credibility to influence or to improve these plans or policies and designs, and as such, to help you in creating better and attractive cities. Do you want to know how? At DTV Capacity Building, we are creating actionable training courses with a personal touch, on-site and online. We offer both open and tailor-made courses for all types of organizations across the world. Our programs are Dutch-infused and designed to adapt the learnings to your local situation. Our motto is learn today, apply tomorrow. Well, what makes us unique then? Originating from a university, teaching and training is in our DNA. We've been offering training courses for more than 25 years now. Well, we know a thing or two about capacity building, and this is acknowledged by our alumni from all over the world. Together with my colleagues that wrote the Crow Bike Design Manual, I will teach you all about bicycle infrastructure planning and design, and of course the crucial elements that are related to that, such as road safety, safe system, policy making, and community engagement. Do you want to know more? visit our website at dtvcapacitybuilding.com. Read our blog, the testimonials of our alumni. Download a free study guide. Or join me in my monthly webinar. Get in touch with me directly. I'm looking forward to get in touch with you and to help you in creating safe and successful bicycle infrastructure. My name is Thaye Goris.
Thanks very much, Thaye. Thanks for being here and thanks for your introduction. And we go to the next presenters of this show. And those are, are they coming? A warm, very warm welcome. Maya van der Voet and Mirjam Borsboom. Maya van der Voet, Program Manager at Tour de Force, and Mirjam Borsboom, responsible for international cycling strategies and policies. It's fantastic to have you both here. And at first, I will give the floor to Maya.
Thank you very much, Lucas. I would like to introduce the best practice book of Dutch cycling we have made from the Tour de Force and the Dutch Cycling Embassy. And of course, we didn't make this book just on our own, but we were working with several parties, with a couple of governmental organizations, but also knowledge institutions and also a couple of consulting companies, because this is the way how we work in the Netherlands. We really like to cooperate and work together. Dutch cycling, of course, we did already hear a lot about of it. With the book, we really want to inspire you, all the audience. We want to give you a couple of famous and perhaps also a couple of examples which are not so famous. And we really want to give you an inspiration how you can work with cycling and what you can actually see on the streets. We want to give you examples how to make the bicycle infrastructure a great success. But of course, it's not only about bicycle infrastructure. It's a lot more. It's also how to organize and also soft skills. So what's important to make cycling a success? With this book, we cannot offer you a cookbook that guarantees you success, but we tried to present all the ingredients that you would need to make cycling a success. And I think we can make clear with the book that you really need all of the ingredients and you really have to mix them right to cook a nice cycling soup, I would say. We have learned an overarching lesson with our experience in the Netherlands. Really don't be afraid to get started and really don't be afraid to experiment with cycling. Dutch cycling hasn't been always like that. We have experience with 50 years of cycling policy, and we have seen a lot of development and progress, and we really would like to encourage you to get started and make it nicer and better. And don't be afraid to make mistakes in it. The COVID-19, of course, fundamentally changed the way we looked at cities. We try to use this window of opportunity here in the Netherlands, but internationally we also see that we have great opportunities to really work on nicer and better cities. And with this, it's really important that it's not only about cycling. So of course, we all like cycling, especially the people who are working on it in the Netherlands, but it's a lot, it's about more. It's about how to create nicer environments, nicer cities. It's about prosperity. It's about social impact to make nicer cities for happy people. And cycling really helps us in these strategies. The best practice book. Yeah, where to start? Because there are so many nice examples, and the people who have worked on the book really had trouble to get the nicest examples for you. So I really want to encourage you to just read it all. I want to highlight two examples. Of course, the Tour de Force, which is the national agenda of cycling here in the Netherlands. And you will see, we started with the national agenda 6 years ago, and we already have 24 partners from several organizations who are working on the goal to improve cycling and really get 20% more cycling in between 10 years, And it's nice to see that it really works and we all can find each other. What Dutch Cycling Embassy is internationally, we would do with the Tour de Force on the national agenda. One example I would like to highlight, it's the Star Cycling route here in the city of The Hague. The city really wants to improve cycling by 50% in between 20 years. That's a nice engagement, and therefore they really upgrade the network, and they really want to connect the city center with the outskirts, and they're building on nice cycling routes, which encourage cycling streets, cycling bridges. So really people can get fast and quickly between the outskirts to the city center. So I guess I did give you a very small impression of the best practice book of the Dutch cycling. And right now I would like to offer the book to my colleague Mirjam. Mirjam,
thank you much. Nice.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
And we are really hoping that people will be inspired.
Thank you very much. It's quite a
yes. Thank you too.
It's quite a heavy book. First, the heaviest book I've ever held, I think. Thank you very much, Maya.
You're welcome.
Very inspiring words as well. I think the Tour de Force is one of the many examples within the Netherlands as how we approach cycling, which you should really do it together, engage all the different stakeholders to it, combine the different experts and all their knowledge together. And therefore, I'm also very honored to be here today on behalf of the Dutch Ministry of Infrastructure and Water Management. We do a lot on cycling. Of course, we could do more, as always. But I think this is one of the great examples where we need to show on what we are doing. The different cities in the Netherlands, municipalities, provinces, and also we as a general government, we really put an effort in cycling. And you should take cycling as a serious mode of transport to get somewhere, I think. And also adding the budget to that in that phase. I think with this book, I think more than 60 pages full of inspiration from inner city approaches like bicycle streets, I'm very a big fan of, to also the cycling highways between the cities. I think we just saw one from the city of The Hague, where we are right now as well, and it's of course a beautiful parking facility. I think all these different ingredients are part of the mix which you need. And as the team from the Dutch Cycling Embassy always indicates, you need the hardware, the software, and the orgware for that. So the hardware, as we see right now, place to park, but also the infrastructure. On the other hand, we have the software side, which is more the behavioral side of infrastructure. How do you get people on the bike and to use that nice infrastructure when you have it? And of course the orgware, which I think is the Dutch Cycling Embassy, but also the Tour de Force are beautiful examples of to really work together, strengthen forces, and therefore really, and also celebrate, I think, because that's sometimes what we forget. We just work very hard, but we forget to celebrate, so I'm very happy to be here, and thank you so much for the book. Thank you
very
much. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Maya and Mirjam, for being here and for taking over this best practices guide. And maybe for the audience to know, it's not that big. It's also just in normal size. It's available in a printed edition, but also as PDF. It's downloadable from the website of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. As Maya already indicated in her presentation, dutchcycling.nl/best practices. So feel free, it's totally also free, so just feel free to download it for free and enjoy the best practices from the Netherlands. Thanks very much for being here this afternoon. Thanks for your presentations and take care. We'll go over to the next presentation, and that's Melissa Brandlet from Mobicom. She will be the next presenter. Melissa, warm welcome. You are the International Communications Specialist at Mobicom. And you will tell something about the Mobicon Academy. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Lucas. And thanks, everyone, for watching. As Lucas said, I'm the International Communication Specialist at Mobicon here in the Netherlands. And today I'm going to talk to you about a platform we started about 7 months ago called Mobicon Academy that focuses on sharing Dutch knowledge, which is why we're all here. So what is the Academy? Essentially, you know, with the pandemic launching, we found ourselves unable to travel to deliver the workshops and masterclasses we got very used to sending and doing in person. And so we started testing out doing things on YouTube and doing a few webinars and study tours, and found there was a real thirst for it. And so in November of 2020, we launched the subscription-based platform of Mobicon Academy, allowing people the opportunity to come and learn with us digitally in a variety of topics. And it's open to people all around the world. So it allows us to connect with people even if they're not here in the Netherlands or where we were traveling to. So what do we cover? We do basically a variety of topics, anything that we normally do in our work days with Mobicon. So that's everything from bicycle and pedestrian planning, network planning, traffic safety, public space, community engagement. Everything under the gamut is something that we try to cover with our webinars. So there's lots to do. And it's done with a collaboration of all of our team. So we have experts both here in the Netherlands and also in our offices in Canada and the US. So we collaborate across oceans as well with this technology we're all getting used to. And it's a real way for us to show our expertise, but also highlight people that maybe don't get to be in front of the camera as often. What we offer are a series of webinars. So we do all those topics that I mentioned earlier, 45-minute to an hour sessions with Q&A, highlighting some of the work that we do. And like has been mentioned, applying that in practice at an international level. So it's not copy-paste, it's learning from each other and finding out how to apply that elsewhere. We also do digital study tours. So just like we can't travel other places, people can't come here and experience Netherlands like they used to be able to. And so we started offering 360-degree tours of various cities, showing off some of the technical aspects and how those could be applied at an international level. And it's also a really nice way to experience Netherlands if you can't be here in person. We also have had the pleasure of hosting a lot of international and local guests, so experts working in the Netherlands in mobility design and policy planning and others, but also people from Europe like Jill Warren from the ECF and colleagues working for various municipalities in the US and Canada. So it's a great way for us to not only share our knowledge, but the knowledge of other experts living in the Netherlands and elsewhere. And with all that, we also offer a digital download library where people can download resources, download previous presentations, and take that learning away with them, because sometimes we don't always remember what we're seeing in the moment, but we can learn from it later. So basically, it's open for everyone. You can join for free. It is a subscription base, but it's a quick, easy click. And then you find out about all our events. Be one of the first to find out, and we also have specialized content from time to time, so it's a good chance to learn about that right away. You can subscribe at academy.mobicon.com. We also have a YouTube channel people can subscribe to watch previous sessions and learn more of what we're doing. So I have a little bit of a video. That's the Academy. Thank you again, Lucas, and to the Dutch Cycling Embassy for having me. I look forward to seeing everyone at the Academy.
Thanks very much, Melissa, for this great content, and great to know more about the Mobicon Academy. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, and then we go to the next two speakers. Back again to Joost de Kruij from the Breda University of Applied Sciences and Tije Gorris, DTV Capacity Building, for an overview of the Dutch Knowledge Clips.
Yes, thanks for that, Lucas. We are back here, Joost, to tell a bit about Knowledge Clips. But probably you've been listening for quite a while now. So before we dig into this, I would like to start with a short, small experiment. And I really would like to invite you back home, you, Joost, and everybody here to work with, together with me on this. So Joost, you are my guinea pig.
Can I leave my clothes on?
Yes. Don't worry about that. So just have a look at me. So
okay.
I want you to take three deep breaths, you two there at home. So just...
Yep, I'm at ease.
Okay, close your eyes. Okay, now I would like to ask you to think back when you're just a little kid. It's a sunny afternoon when you were about 2 to 3 years old. Can you imagine it?
That's way back, but yeah. I have a picture.
Your mom is inviting you to get an ice cream. So she's getting her mom's bike, of course. You are in the child seat behind. She's cycling, and you feel the hair, you feel the wind in your hair. Do you imagine it?
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
Happy.
Good. Now, a couple of steps further. If you think about you learning to ride your bike, so it's 1, 2 years later, perhaps. So you have a small bike, and then you're on it. Are you there?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you there as well? You are riding it, and you see the sidewalk approaching, and you cannot avoid it. Then you fall. Ouch! That hurts. And another time, and then you fall again, and you fall again. But then, the following time, your dad gives you a push, and you ride. You ride all by yourself. How does that make you feel?
Again, happy.
Okay. Now, just one more exercise. Think of your older son when you taught him to ride for the first time. When you gave him this push and he started to ride by himself. How does that make you feel?
Yeah, amazing that he accomplished that.
Yeah, that's great. That's perhaps recognizable. You can open your eyes. That's perhaps recognizable for all moms and dads over here. I have the same. I also did the same with my my kids, of course. But this is also this tremendous feeling I get when I provide these trainings, when I teach the participants in these training courses. And I think that is the feeling that drives us here in our learn activities. So besides, as Lucas already explained, teaching others to ride by yourself, I think very important. Learning to ride by yourself brings you further. I think that is the metaphor we can take out of this this exercise.
Yeah, definitely. And I think you put something else on the screen, and it's really interesting to have maybe explain to the people at home too. At first, the Cycling Embassy had the experience Think and Act, and then to position also the academic and the applied academic partners in the Dutch Cycling Embassy, we get into a conversation. Can we add our part to the game? So that's the cycling intelligence, but also how do we learn collectively? So it's really nice to say that all the partners giving the pitches are also in the learning part. So it's the practical, the applied scientific, and the scientific, because maybe it's good to mention that we also collaborate with TU Delft and, for example, the University of Amsterdam or other academic partners in this. So that's nice.
Yeah, and I think that you are touching upon a great point over there. So we have the academics, you have the universities of applied sciences, we have the private sector here, all bringing you the best, we have to offer and adapt it to your local situation. And of course, as briefly shown, all that we have available here. It's online, so we have the different offerings on the website of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. But let's dig into this a little bit further. And learning requires some active participation. It's achieving your learning objectives. It is about teaching others. That involves didactics, here and there a test or some validation. And above all, effort by yourself, by you. And what we experienced, Joost, in teaching us, teaching your classes in the trainings, and probably the others around here recognize this as well, is you come to talk about same elements. okay, what is the history of Dutch cycling? How about road safety? How about protected lanes, intersections?
Yeah.
And we thought, let's make this a bit easier, right?
Yeah, right. And I have to add something to that, because normally, as teaching either professionals or young professionals, the essence is that in the past we were used to tell everybody what we know. And in flipping the classroom, it's more important that you try to accelerate active learning. So what we normally do and do moreover is sending information in advance that people can do their homework. And then if you meet, you have an active interaction with your audience. So that's, I think, also the good introduction to the knowledge clips, which we now show at the screen. Because the important thing is what we started, and that's the big relation to the philosophy about the cycling intelligence, as I tried to explain earlier on. These knowledge clips have been developed by all kinds of different specialists from the Netherlands, what they know about cycling. And I can imagine that people from out the world say, yeah, but the Dutch don't know everything. That's true if you click the button once, because there is one, and I'm not sure if you know this guy, but this is Dr. Elliot Fishman. He works in Australia, and he has been an appreciated colleague of ours at Utrecht University. And Elliot knows everything about bike sharing. And the important thing is, and that's also what we take in mind, if there is somebody who knows a lot, I would not say all, because I earlier explained that I think that's quite infeasible at this stage, but I think by adding Elliot to the knowledge clips, it's also a nice stepping stone for other people who say, okay, I have really something interesting to tell about a specific topic within the plan, design, build, sell, or evaluate phase, to help out people with short knowledge clips about the essence, where they can have a starting point for knowing more.
Yeah, yeah, that's well put there, Joost. So if I take this correctly, we have two main purposes, at least two main purposes for these cycling clips. Is one, to have some common knowledge or common Dutch cycling intelligence put on the screen. It's free, it's on YouTube there, available for everybody to use. So it's the distribution of cycling intelligence. And the second part is to enhance our academic programs, our applied programs, and the trainings and courses we are telling you about today. So that we actually, in our sessions, can really engage and make it interactive. Because, as you know from experience, as we all know from experience, well, developing cycling infrastructure, growing a cycling culture, it's a continuous process, and it's really tailoring to each situation. So I think that is also important, that that is reflected in our training programs there.
Yeah, and I think when we move on to the next slide, because it's really important to have understanding, we now tape several of the knowledge clips, but it's a continuous process. I earlier explained a really nice thing about qualitative research methods on cycling behavior. Those particular, let's say, silver bullets, we are also going to introduce, and I think it's good to tell the audience at home, but they can ask Lucas if they say, okay, it's really important and I came to the Netherlands, or I saw something really great in Paris. Do you know anybody who particularly knows something about that topic? It's really great to have new knowledge clips. So that's, it's a growing thing, that if you are going to come to the Netherlands and see something great, that you have some background information how it came about.
Yeah, yeah, that's and of course these clips, and I think there we are working towards the conclusion of this this session there. It's with all the experts in there, I think the energy that was there in making that, I think that really comes close to the exercise we started with. And I think that is, well, besides the content, that is an important thing that we want to convey over here. So
yeah.
We are working towards more knowledge clips. So if you have ideas or needs, please, well, contact Lucas, I would say, and then we will try to make it happen.
Thanks very much. That's a wonderful presentation. And for those who still are eager to find out the knowledge ships that are already there, they are to be visited on the website of the Dutch Cycling Embassy. There you can see it on the YouTube screen as well, the channel.
Yeah, they are under the projects part of the menu. So they are perhaps a little bit hidden. So
Go to the projects part.
Website projects part.
We are going to reschedule later on our website, and it's even more easy to find. But for now, go to the project website on the Dutch Cycling Embassy. There's one question from the audience.
Oh, great.
And that relates to, of course, partly to the exercise that you started, Tijen. It relates to children cycling and the learning of that. And maybe it's an idea, maybe very shortly can tell about how the didactic skills and kids are to be learned, or refer to maybe a knowledge clip that is still to be produced specifically focused at kids. It was just a question that pops up, and it popped up due to your fantastic answer.
So if I understand correct, this is a suggestion to also develop a clip on, well, tips and tricks to teach your kids to ride a bike.
But I think it's relevant because in our, as you mentioned, my oldest boy, he's in the football team, and there is a German boy with him, and he wears a bike helmet, and they're cycling alongside on the same street together after training. So it's really a nice topic to take up in future. Yeah, good suggestion.
Absolutely. Fantastic. Yes. And of course, there are loads of other questions and other elements. I think a part of your earlier presentation, Joost, about the bike train combination, they're already there. There's a knowledge clip specifically focusing on that and all other stuff to learn from. So go check it out. Thanks very much for your presentation.
Thank you. Okay.
And then we go to the next one. That's Lior Steinberg. There it is. co-founder of Humankind. Happy to have you here, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so my name is Lior Steinberg. I'm an urban planner and the co-founder of Humankind. And at Humankind, we are working with cities and organizations to foster urban change. I want to tell you my story and how we started this course and the platform that I'm going to present. And it's quite a simple story of an international, someone coming from outside the Netherlands and discovering heaven of cycling. Now, everybody, I guess, if you're watching it, you like cycling and you want to have the same experience of cycling in the Netherlands, in your country. But most likely that this is how the bicycle infrastructure in your city looks like. So I think this is always the gap between what we hope to have in our country and what we actually have in reality. And the route to a perfect bicycle culture has a lot of great intentions, but a lot of terrible infrastructure. And that's why we decided to create, together with George Liu, the Designing the Cycling City course. So, what we're doing in this course? We first really speak about the fundamentals. What is a bike lane? What is a contraflow bike lane? How we create a bicycle intersection? The types of separation between a bike infrastructure to other other infrastructures and road users. But we also give really the basic skills of planning a bicycle city, how to convince other stakeholders that cycling is important, how to sell your idea, how to design your idea using free tools like SketchUp and Google Slides. And at the end of the course, you are creating, and this is an example of one of our students, you're creating your own pitch. You're choosing your street, redesigning it, and creating a new design for your street, which you can take later on to your colleagues or to your city hall and sell. Now, this is a course that we're giving for free, together with the EAT Urban Mobility, so it's by the European Union. You can also pay a little bit and get a certificate at the end. And we're offering more courses, so we're offering a designing cycling city course. We're offering tools to design your urban ideas in general, understanding cycling in Europe, and user experience design. And we're doing it together with different companies and different colleagues, and together with EAT Urban Mobility. You can find it all at the Urban Mobility Courses. It's very easy, .eu. You can register from today. It's online. Get the courses for free. Interact with other students, and create a better cycling city. Thanks a lot.
Thanks very much, Lior. Thanks for this fantastic insight and the offering of free courses. Thanks, and see you later. Yeah, and now we are going to have a virtual tour of this fantastic bike parking garage underneath the central station of the city of The Hague. Earlier on, I visited this bike parking garage, and I was given a tour by Hidde van der Bel, who is senior policy advisor of the Department of Urban Mobility of the municipality of The Hague. Let's see what we encountered down here and what Hidde teached me. So, give it a go.
My name is Lucas Harms from the Dutch Cycling MSC, and today we are going to explore one of the largest bike parking facilities in the world. Let's explore this treasure. This is Hidde van der Bel from the city of The Hague. He's going to give me a tour to this huge facility. Thanks for having us.
Yes, of course, Lucas. It's a pleasure.
Before we start, I just came down with 6 escalators. Huge number. Why so many?
Well, you have to imagine this is a huge facility for 8,000 bicycles. So during rush hour, a lot of people coming in and out at the same time. So we wanted to make sure that even in the busiest moments, we would not have any congestion. So people waiting outside or inside for going onto the escalator, because that could be dangerous.
Wow, that's interesting. Shall we start with the tour?
Yes, let's go. So here we are in the check-in zone. Everybody has to pass this area to check in their bicycle. So during rush hour, a lot of people have to pass this area. So we made it extra spacious with a lot of places where you can check in. So when you enter the bicycle facility, you check in over here. And when you leave, you can check out at the exit counter. You can park for free for 24 hours. After 24 hours, you have to pay.
Okay, let's check in.
Wow.
Do you really need so many public transport bikes?
Well, we have 700 of them, so I think it's enough. But it's quite popular in The Hague. I think it's because of the beach. People take them to go to the beach on a sunny day.
Wow, it feels so spacious and so enormous.
True, because that's one of the key elements of this bicycle park. We want the people give a spacious feeling. So, for instance, the ceiling is 3.5 meters high, which is 0.5 meter higher than standard for bicycle parking facilities. This bicycle parking facility is so big that we wanted people to be able to cycle inside. You can see the green lines here on the floor. People can cycle in this area, and then they can park their bicycle, and then they can walk to the exit. At the exit, you will have yellow lines, and the yellow lines will guide you as a pedestrian to the train station.
Okay, let's try it out.
That's a great experience. It's so spacious. It's an enormous layout, and then you have these fantastic design elements like these walls.
Yes, we are very proud of it. So if you look at this wall, it's inspired by the works of M.C. Escher, a Dutch artist, which is famous because of his optical illusions. And here in The Hague, we have a museum about his work. So the designers of Silo, they took the key elements of famous buildings from the city and morph them into each other on this glass panel.
So while being down here, you can experience the city.
Exactly. So for example, over here, you can see our new cultural palace, Amare, morphing into our Museum of Modern Art, KM21.
Thanks very much for the tour, Hidde. And now I have to catch a train.
Which direction do I have to go? It was a pleasure having you. You can just follow the yellow lines, they will take you to the exit.
Thanks!
See you!
Thanks very much, Hidde, for this wonderful tour. There's already a lot explained in this short movie. Maybe you can elaborate a little bit more about it.
Yes, of course, Lucas. I'm happy to do it. So I will take you a little bit through the design philosophy of this bicycle parking. And I also will tell you a little bit about what's going to happen above ground, because we only showed you underground this far. Well, Like I told you in the movie before, we have a design philosophy where we want to have a logical and efficient flow for users. So easy route finding and easy to park your bicycle and continue to the train station. Secondly, we also wanted to have spacious and light, so which you already can see already in this area where we are standing now. And at the same, we also wanted to have a look and feel with a high quality. We call it state of art. Well, when we started with this project, we took a few elements. Obviously, you have an entrance and you have an exit. When you enter the facility, you are on your bicycle. And when you leave, you are a pedestrian without your bicycle. And in somewhere in between, you have to do you have to park your bicycle. But for instance, also what we developed was the check-in and check-out zone, which we showed you in the video. And we wanted to make it like a journey which is very logical, without having cyclists and pedestrians interfere with each other, because that can be annoying and even dangerous. So this is the. This is the map of the bicycle parking, and you can see the green lines show you the area where people are when they're on their bicycle. They will go down on the enter on the left on the arrow, then they will check in at the bottom, and then they can cycle the areas where you can see the symbol with the bicycle, and then in these bike paths on the side. You can park your bicycle and then you walk towards the yellow lines, and from the yellow lines you can go to exit like you already showed us in the movie. This way we can also quite evenly fill up the bicycle parking and prevent that everybody wants to park the bicycle in one place. Well, we also wanted to have it spacious and light. So we start with this element of the high ceilings and the white cycle paths, but also the light colors and the higher light intensity contributes to the fact that it feels a nice and pleasant environment. We even went to other bicycle parkings in the Netherlands to measure the light intensity to see whether we wanted to have it higher or lower. And we wanted to have room to maneuver. So even in the areas where you have to park your bicycle, you have enough space to pass each other when somebody is busy with parking their bicycle. Well, and then we come to the look and feel, the state of art. Well, actually, it's a catch. The state of art, of course, says something about that you want to have a high quality, sophisticated, top of bill bicycle parking. And at the same time, of course, you can see with the facade designed by Silo, which also has an art element in it. Maybe also interesting to tell something about the entrance with the six escalators. We can change direction of those escalators. So in the morning, we can have four going down and two going up. And then, for instance, in the evening, when people are arriving more at the train station and taking the bicycle to go back home, we can change direction to four up and two down. This way we can make sure we have enough capacity in the entrance. Also what we did is that we have a bike detection system, which means that every place in this parking facility is being watched by a sensor, which will say whether the position is occupied or not. And this way, we can guide cyclists to the places which are free. Especially at this moment, that's of course not a problem because it's not so full. But when we are reaching max capacity, you want to help people to find those last empty spots. Well, I'll tell you something about above ground. You see the building with all the lights. Those are two 90 meters high towers, and they will start construction of this building somewhere later this year, and it will have like around 400 apartments and around 2,000 square meters of commercial space, and it will have like terraces. So the two big towers are connected by like a valley lower structure, which has terraces, which also have trees and green of park. How do you call it? A green area on top of it. And I think the building construction will take around 3 years to totally be finished. But above ground, we are not only going to build those two towers, we also have to redesign the public space around it. Because in the current situations, it's already quite busy with cyclists and pedestrians in front of the central station. And of course, with this huge parking facility, it only gets busier. So what we are going to do, we are going to do traffic calming, which means we're going to decrease the speed limit on the road to 30 kilometers. And at the same time, we are going to make more space for cyclists, pedestrians, but with bigger bike paths coming in and out of the parking facility. Well, I'm up for some questions.
Thanks very much, Hidde, for this fantastic presentation and the virtual tour in this giant bike parking facility. Yeah, there are a couple of questions. Maybe one question to start off with is, and that's for Dutch people, maybe very obvious, but for people international audience, maybe not so. But why is it important for the municipality at the first place to enable cycling towards the station?
Well, not only for the city of The Hague, but also actually every city in general, which has a big train station. The combination bicycle and train is very important in the Netherlands because it creates a trip which is much longer than only the bicycle trip. It's the combination of the train and the bicycle trip, which can compete with a car trip, and that's very, of course, very important because of accessibility of the cities itself, because we will otherwise clog up with car traffic. So it's very important to have good parking facilities at train stations, so it's interesting to take the train in the first place.
Fantastic. I don't know if that's a question that can be answered out in the open, but there's one person that's asking what the total budget was for this whole project. And if you calculate it down to per square meter, if that's possible, I don't know if you can answer that, but...
Yeah, well, of course. Well, the total costs are around 37 million for this huge facility, and it comes down to around 4,500 euros per bike space, yes.
Yeah, and then it relates, of course, back what you the first answer, that it's a very important ingredient of the Dutch mobility system, to influence and enable this bike-train combination, and therefore, if you relate it to the bigger picture, it's not that much money.
No, it's not. A car parking also costs a lot of money, and it can you can store much less cars in it.
So. Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah, thanks very much. It's wonderful to be here, and also thanks for hosting us here in this beautiful bike parking garage. We feel really honored to be broadcasting from here. So everybody can look back at the picture, at the virtual cycling tour, and of course, if you happen to be in The Hague, feel free to contact us or Hidde from the City of The Hague, and we can show you around personally as well.
Yes.
Thanks very much. Thanks for being here. And with that, I would love to give over the floor to the next presenters. And they are coming. Very warm welcome. Ilse Galema from Goudappel and Rehan Safari from Move Mobility. Thanks for being here. You are going to tell something about the Excellent Cities Academy. Take the floor.
Welcome to the Excellent Cities Academy. Excellent cities are economically vital, sustainable, resilient, attractive, and socially equitable. We believe in the power of mobility planning as a critical tool for governments to improve their cities. Our Excellent Cities Academy shares the experiences of Dutch mobility planning, which is recognized for being one of the most sustainable and efficient systems in the world. The Academy offers tailor-made programs for you and your organization, such as a masterclass, summer school, webinar, or a site visit. In collaboration with our Dutch partners, universities, and governments, we cover a variety of topics from our areas of expertise. Those are integrated urban planning, mobility hubs, bicycle inclusive planning, road safety, street design, smart mobility, and modeling and data handling.
The Excellent Cities Academy is part of Goudappel and Move Mobility. Together we provide more than 60 years of experience in urban mobility planning for cities worldwide. Visit us at excellentcities.com or contact Rehan or Ilse.
Thanks, Lucas. Hello everyone, my name is Rehan Safari and I work as an urban planner at Move Mobility and Goudappel, and maybe I can give you one example about our Excellent Cities Academy. We did host a week program for more than 10 different expert groups from Middle East and Africa in the Netherlands and show them how the Dutch mobility system works in real life and from the different perspectives.
And my name is Ilse Galema. I'm an urban mobility consultant at Goudappel. And I'm really excited to be here actually and tell about our Excellent Cities Academy, because it's super really great to share our knowledge on integrated urban planning and our fantastic cycle culture as we have here in the Netherlands. And one of the best experience me myself personally had with our academy was a group of people from Bikes from the US. We hosted in 2019. It was a while ago, unfortunately, but it was a really great experience with about 20 city officials from the States. So hopefully we can do that soon again. Actually, we're planning a summer school in the summer of 2020 with the University of Washington and the University of Manchester. So currently working on the program, the details, and hopefully that can go through. So hope you are as excited as we are in sharing knowledge, experiences, and learn from each other about our fantastic bike culture. And if you'd like to get in touch, please contact me or Rehan.
Thanks very much, Rehan and Ilse, for being here and for presenting the Excellent Cities Academy and all the opportunities. And a sneak preview of what is going to be next year, with hopefully some real life sessions again and tours instead of all these virtual elements. But thanks very much. And with that, we have come almost to the end of the show. I would like to say as sort of a closing word, get into action, go visit us, go look out for the opportunities that are there, the learning opportunities that you can all find on our website or in the respective websites of our partners that presented today. There's lots to be explored and to be learned from. So thanks very much for all attending online. Great that you all have been here, and also thanks very much for all the presenters that had the courage to come here today to be here real life in this bike parking garage. Still hear the sounds from rush hour that is kicking in, people go home, so it's a very energetic environment to be here. So if you have any follow-up questions, don't hesitate to contact us. The contact details of the Dutch Cycling Embassy are shown. And if you want to enroll in one of the DCE learning opportunities that we have mentioned this afternoon, feel free to connect to us and to explore those opportunities and to ask for more information. I wish you all a wonderful evening. Take care and goodbye.